Welcome to Furniture Flipping for Profit. This week's video is part of the Ugly Duckling Challenge sponsored by Corey of Desert DIY. When I saw this mid-century modern dresser posted on Facebook Marketplace, I knew it would be perfect for this challenge because it certainly is an ugly duckling. Full disclosure, I would never recommend that you take on a project like this if you intend to flip it for a profit. It needs too much repair to make it a profitable flip. It is certainly a great dresser for me to show you some new techniques and perhaps you'll learn some new skills. When I purchased this, I planned to completely restore it to its original stained finish. Of course, I have no idea what's under those two layers of paint, one coat of primer, and the original finish. I'm glad you're here so we can go on this journey together. As you can see, this dresser has a lot of damage, and since you should allow wood glue to dry a full 24 hours, I chose to tackle those areas first. Once I flipped the dresser over, I was able to examine the full extent of the damage to the bottom of the dresser. As you can see, the groove in this tongue and groove joint is broken, and the veneer has pulled away from the body of the dresser and its base. Wood glue was applied to both sides of these areas needing repair. Wood glue must have pressure applied while it is drying for it to work correctly. This was the first of many clamps I used to restore this dresser. Every time I glued anything, I applied wood glue generously to both sides, and then when it was clamped, I watched to make certain glue squeezed out. That confirmed that I had used enough glue. This excess glue was wiped off with a damp cloth. If glue dried on the dresser, that area would resist stain. My goal from the beginning was to restore this dresser to its original condition by staining it. Originally, mid-century modern dressers were stained, not painted. Of course, since it's now covered with multiple layers of paint, I have no way to tell if that's even an option. Stay tuned to this video to see if I was able to achieve this goal. The opposite tongue and groove joint on that side of the dresser had failed as well and was completely free moving. The veneer was pulling away from the body of the dresser in this area as well. More glue and more clamping. What you don't see is me going back repeatedly to get more clamps. I don't know why I only brought over a few at a time. The artist's brush helped me to ensure that I was able to get glue down into all of the areas. The veneer had pulled away almost one half of the way down the side of the dresser. There was nothing to clamp the spring clamps onto, so I could add pressure to that area once it was glued. I had several 48-inch trigger clamps, but this dresser was at least 55 inches wide, so I put two of them together so I could clamp from one side of the dresser to the other. I did this twice, so the entire damaged area had even pressure. Just when I thought I had finished, I found there was damage to the tongue and groove joint on the opposite side of the dresser base. This joint had only partially separated, and there was not enough room for a brush, so I filled a syringe with wood glue and used that to insert glue into the joint. Here is a view of all the clamps so you could see the extent of the repairs. I counted them. I used 16 spring clamps and 4 trigger clamps. I think that's a record for me. I've never used that many before. Since it's best to allow wood glue to dry a full 24 hours, I chose to do this repair first. While the wood glue was drying on the body of the dresser, I got started on the drawers. The pulls and the knobs were removed. There were wood pieces attached to the drawers that were secured with screws, so those too were removed. Some of them were painted in place, so I would have to wait until I stripped the paint so I could remove them. I then cleaned the drawers thoroughly with TSP and rinsed them well with water. I use TSP whenever a piece of furniture is especially dirty. Normally I just use crud cutter, but TSP works exceptionally well at getting dirt off. From looking at this dresser, it appeared to be very dirty. As I cleaned the drawer fronts though, I came to realize it wasn't dirt, it was brown glaze that had been applied on top of the yellow and gray paint. I also cleaned the rest of the drawers inside and out. A couple of them had remnants of wallpaper stuck to the bottom and the sides. I let the TSP sit for a while to soften the wallpaper glue and then carefully scraped it off. Each drawer was carefully inspected for damage. Here is one area that had broken off, so it was glued and clamped and allowed to sit overnight. CitriStrip was used to remove the multiple layers of paint, primer, glaze, and the prior stained finish. A heavy coat was applied with a chip brush. The entire area was covered with plastic to keep it from drying out, since I was going to allow it to sit overnight. The next day, a flexible putty knife was used to scrape off the CitriStrip. I scraped and scraped and scraped. I certainly am not going to bore you by showing you all that video. After I removed the layers of paint from the edges of the wood drawer pulls, I was finally able to remove the pulls with the help of a putty knife or chisel. I was careful to place the metal putty knife or chisel in an area that would be hidden from view once the drawer was stained, just in case I scratched the wood while removing the drawer pull. I scraped off as much of the old finish as possible and then applied another heavy coat of the CitriStrip. I checked it at 15-minute intervals to see if the remaining finish had become liquid. After about an hour, the old finish was soft and liquid, so I could easily scrape it off. Since there was an overall white haze in the dresser, as well as a few areas with stubborn finish left, I used the coarsest steel wool you can buy and put more stripper on it. I then scrubbed the dresser drawer, going with the grain of the wood so as not to scratch it, and removed the last remnants of the finish. I used a fresh steel wool pad and mineral spirits to remove all of the paint stripper from the drawer. My understanding is that mineral spirits deactivates the stripper, so the furniture is ready to be painted and stained. I then let it dry overnight. So this is where my project went off the rails. I went to Walmart to get more CitriStrip, just in case I needed it to finish stripping the entire dresser. While I was there, I saw that they sell Kwik Strip as well as another brand called Watco. So I got this big idea to do a side-by-side comparison on the top of the dresser to determine which stripper is best. The only stripper I've ever used on furniture is CitriStrip, so I was curious about the other two. I figured this dresser was a real challenge for any stripper and would serve as a good one to test their ability to remove the multiple coats of paint, primer, and finish. If I divided the dresser top into thirds, I could do an objective test to determine the best one, right? I thought I'd come up with a great idea. I got back to my workshop and did just that. I'm producing a video showing the process and the results of this test, and quite honestly, I was surprised at the end result. There is a difference between the three strippers, and one is clearly inferior to the other two. I'm going to release that video as soon as I get the video you are watching right now finished. I'll put a link at the end of this video as soon as it's released. If you subscribe to my channel and click the notification bell, you'll be notified when it's released. After I stripped most of the finish off the top, I could now see a lot of black stains that look like ink. These were not visible before. So I got out the graffiti remover and I sprayed each stain and let it sit for 1 to 2 minutes. I used a very coarse steel wool like sanding paper on each stain. I repeated this process 3 to 5 times on each stain, and eventually I got them to fade so they were no longer noticeable. The graffiti remover discolored the raw wood a little in the surrounding area, but I knew how to take care of that, so stay tuned to see what I did. The problem with using three different strippers on the top of the dresser is that each of the three areas looked different after they were completely stripped. I had placed masking tape in between the areas, and that too was a different color. The top of the dresser was a mess. If I was going to paint the top, it wouldn't have been a problem, but I had planned to stain it. The moral of this tale of woe is that you should not use different brands of stripper on a piece of furniture you plan to stain. If you just so happen to do so, then watch the rest of this video to see what I had to do to correct my error. The first thing I did to try to correct the top was to re-strip it with Watco using the same process I described earlier. This removed all of the finish, but as you can see in this photo, the color was not even, and you could still see the stripes from the masking tape. I hoped that sanding it would take care of these problems, so I sanded it with 180 grit sandpaper. However, after sanding, I could still see the lines, so I applied an even coat of outdoor bleach to the entire top. Outdoor bleach is a highly concentrated form of bleach, so it worked a lot faster at bleaching out the color on the raw wood. I was hoping to even out the color across the top and remove the masking tape lines. I applied the bleach 4 times over about 3 hours. The fumes from this bleach are very strong, so you need to use it in a well-ventilated area, wear a good respirator, and of course, gloves. This outdoor bleach did the trick. Since it's difficult nowadays to purchase the 2-part wood bleaching kits online or at a big box store, this outdoor bleach is a great option. It's less expensive and it worked well. I purchased this at Home Depot. When the top appeared to be an even color throughout, I stopped applying bleach because I knew it was finished. I then applied full-strength vinegar with a coarse steel wool pad and scrubbed the surface to remove any remaining stripper and bleach. I used a lot of paper towels to remove the vinegar and residue. I let it dry overnight, and the next day I sanded the top one last time with 180 grit sandpaper to get rid of the raised grain caused by the bleaching. The same process was repeated on the 6 drawers. The CitriStrip had left the drawers blotchy with light and dark areas on each drawer. I was afraid that the stain would affect the wood differently on the drawers so the final color wouldn't match the rest of the dresser. I'm not going to bore you by showing you the hours of video I have re-stripping the drawers, bleaching them, etc., since it's the same process you just saw on the top. At this point, I was still planning to stain the entire dresser as well as the drawers, but I had not yet stripped the sides of the dresser. There were 2 parallel scratches on the top of the dresser. This scratched area was about 8 inches long. I wanted to try to minimize it so it would be less noticeable when it was stained. I could tell that the scratch didn't go all the way through the veneer. In essence, the scratch just kind of flattened the wood fibers. I've used this trick in other videos, so you may have seen it before, but never have I used it on such a severe scratch. I figured I had nothing to lose. Worst case scenario, I would fill it in with wood filler and paint the dresser top black. I used a regular household steam iron with lots of water in the reservoir so it would generate lots of steam. I tried a couple of techniques, but the thing that worked best was to use a paintbrush to put water on the scratch and then literally iron the wood with bursts of steam going at the same time. I did this for about 3 to 4 minutes, checking it frequently. Of course, the concept here is to make the wood swell with the heat and steam slash water. This water slash steam method really worked. Running my hand across it, I could hardly feel the scratch. I'll show you the final stained and sealed result at the end of this video. Are you getting exhausted yet, watching all that I went through to restore this dresser? It took me 8 days in total, full time, and you've only seen about half the video so far. I still have more challenges to show you. If you feel that you've gotten some good information from this video, I would appreciate it if you'd give it a thumbs up. That helps my channel a lot because it tells YouTube that this video is of value and that others would benefit from seeing it also. If you become a subscriber and click the notification bell, you'll be notified when I post my weekly videos. At this point in the project, I still have 2 sides to strip. I use the same stripping technique to apply 2 coats of stripper, scraping the finish off after each application. A 3rd thinner coat of stripper was applied with coarse steel wool pads saturated with stripper to scrub the entire side of any remaining finish. The stripper was removed with a paper towel, and then mineral spirits were applied with a fresh steel wool pad to scrub off any remaining stripper, and it was again wiped down with paper towels. Once the old paint and finish was removed, I was able to inspect the damaged areas and make more needed repairs. On the right side, I filled in the bottom where the veneer had broken off with good filler, wood filler. I also filled in the hole where it looked like a sharp object had punctured the dresser. I used wood glue to repair the peeling veneer and held that in place with masking tape until it was dry. When the wood filler was dry, I sanded it to ensure a smooth, flat surface that would not be noticeable under the paint. On the left side of the dresser, the bottom was so damaged that wood filler was used to fill in the missing veneer and reconstruct the bottom edge so again the area was straight and flat and looked like it had when it was new. The most striking thing about the left side was the discovery that there was a large area that had been poorly filled in with wood filler. This area was a poor repair because it was very obvious when looking at the painted dresser. Unfortunately, I didn't notice this until I began to strip this side of the dresser. With the removal of the paint, the full extent of the damage was revealed, and I knew that my plan to stain the dresser was no longer an option. That was when I made the decision to paint the body of the dresser black. I still hoped to be able to stain the top of the dresser and the six drawers. The previously damaged area was filled in correctly this time with DAP wood filler, and when everything was dry, it was sanded smooth. Here is a sneak peek at the finished dresser. As you can see from this photo, there's no evidence of the repairs to this side of the dresser. Most mid-century modern dressers have tapered legs, so I purchased some 8-inch legs from Amazon. I determined how much of the legs I wanted exposed and found that about 6 inches would make the legs look in proportion to the dresser. This required that I build up the base used to secure the legs to the dresser. I used 2 boards to achieve the proper thickness. Before nailing them in place, I carefully measured the placement of the boards to make certain that they were the same distance from the front to the back and that the bases of both boards would be equal. I wanted to point out the tape measure I'm using. I don't know about you, but those little marks on a tape measure drive me crazy. I can never determine the proper measurement by counting the lines. This tape measure that I'm using has fractions written on it, so you can easily see and remember what a measurement is. In this case, the measurement was 2 1/4 inches, so instead of having to remember 2 inches and 3 little lines, I could remember 2 1/4 inches. I thought I'd mention it here in case you didn't know that such a tape measure existed. The boards making up the base of the tapered legs were nailed into place using a brad nailer. I noticed for the first time that a brace was missing on the left side, so I cut a triangle from one of the extra boards I used to make the leg bases. I brad nailed this brace into place so it would stay in position when I drilled the holes for the screws. I then drilled 2 holes so the screws would not split the wood. The brace was then screwed permanently to the base of the dresser with a screw on each end. Since the legs have a sealer on them and I wanted to stain them to match the dresser, I sanded off the sealer with my orbital sander to expose the raw wood. The legs were made of birch, and this wood is notorious for not taking stain evenly, so I applied a pre-stain wood conditioner first. The dresser is made of dark mahogany, so I had to stain the tapered legs 3 times to achieve a dark enough color to match the rest of the dresser. I had never used a water-based stain before, but I found it to be very easy to layer on additional coats to make it darker. When the legs were dry, I sealed them with the matte polyurethane I planned to use on the rest of the dresser. To install the legs, I screwed each leg to the metal base that came with the legs. However, I learned last time when I purchased these legs that the screws that come with them are not strong enough because the legs popped off the first time I righted that dresser. This time I used 1 1/4 inch wood screws to secure the metal base onto the legs as well as the legs onto the previously installed dresser base. These legs are now nice and secure. I decided to use my all-in-one DIY paint recipe for this dresser. The quality of this final paint is determined by the quality of the interior latex paint used to make it. Anytime I make it with Oops paint, I always check the final quality of my all-in-one paint by doing a series of tests to evaluate its durability and wearability. I used these same tests in a recent video that I will link at the end of this video where I compared Beyond Paint versus chalk paint. You too can easily perform these same tests on a DIY paint that you create with latex paint. I found that using a lower quality latex paint does not work very well to make all-in-one paint. I use only matte, flat, satin, or eggshell finish latex paint and satin or flat water-based polyurethane. Since I wanted to paint this dresser black, I wanted a specific color of black, so I purchased Ovation paint from Lowe's in the color New Black in a flat finish. I didn't want any shine on this dresser. Even though I paid $35 a gallon for this paint, it was still cheaper to make my own DIY paint than it was to purchase all-in-one paint from a company. Now I have a lot of extra black latex that I can make more all-in-one paint or chalk paint. I had used Ovation in a recent makeover and it performed flawlessly, so that's why I chose that paint as the base of this project. I have two all-in-one paint recipes. One uses latex paint with primer, and the other recipe is for latex paint without primer. Both recipes are on my blog, and the link will be in the description for this video. My recipe for chalk paint will also be posted. I mixed up the paint using flat water-based polyurethane and stirred it very well at the beginning and frequently as I painted the dresser. I wanted a very smooth finish, so I used a car washing sponge to apply it. I found that using a dabbing motion worked best. Note that I'm only lifting the sponge about a quarter of an inch above the surface as I dab on the paint. It always looks bad after the first coat, but the second coat provided the finishing touch of covering it well, resulting in a smooth finish. I didn't even have to sand in between coats. This was a huge time saver. Since it had primer, paint, and sealer in one, I could skip those steps as well as all the sanding in between. I suggest you give this recipe a try. You won't be disappointed. It makes finishing furniture so easy. As you can see, I applied the paint to the body of the dresser. It took only about an hour to dry in between coats. Another thing I don't want to forget to mention is about touching up this paint. If you need to touch it up, you simply dab a little of the all-in-one paint on the area. Chalk painters know that you simply can't touch up furniture that has been painted with chalk paint that has been sealed and waxed. I always give my clients some of the paint I used so they can use it as needed to touch up any nicks, etc. As you recall, someone had drilled holes in the four drawers and installed knobs. These knobs were not original to the dresser and were not needed since it had wood drawer pulls that were actually a really cool design element. I had already filled in the holes with wood filler and now I needed to do something so I could stain the block where the pulls had been. The solution was to put new veneer over this area. I wanted the veneer to be a different type of wood and I wanted the color of this wood to look differently from the rest of the dresser. I've never applied veneer before. So I watched several YouTube videos about how to apply veneer. It seems that there are a variety of methods, some a lot more complex than others, in installing veneer. Well, I believe in the acronym KISS, and when I found that you can buy real wood veneer with a glue backing that works like contact paper, I knew that I had found the right product. I purchased the 12-inch by 20-inch sheets on Amazon. It was unbelievably easy to apply. I measured the area carefully and added 1/4 inch to each side. I then cut the veneer with the scissors. I removed the backing a little at a time while I slowly pushed down on the veneer with my DIY application tool, and voila, it was done. They recommend using a brayer, but honestly, I forgot to bring it from home, so my little tool worked just fine. I found that cutting it from the back with a utility knife worked perfectly. Of course, I made certain that I had a fresh blade on my knife, and I held my breath while I cut it. I think my toes were crossed too, since I had to use my fingers to apply the veneer and I couldn't cross them. I then sanded the edges to smooth out any rough edges. Gosh, I was proud of myself. The top right drawer was missing the drawer slide, so I used a piece of wood I had in my shop and cut it to size with a table saw. Sorry, but I apparently forgot to turn the camera on, so I didn't get that on video. I drilled a hole at each end and then screwed it in place. I used Minwax water-based stain in the color chestnut to stain the drawers and the top. The drawers, including the new veneer, were sanded with 240 grit sandpaper. I used a damp cloth to remove the dust and then used a car washing sponge to apply one coat of the stain. It was immediately wiped off with paper towels. According to the manufacturer's instructions, I waited 3 hours to apply 3 coats of the water-based polyurethane. Of course, I allowed the poly to dry in between coats. The wood poles had been painted with black all-in-one paint, and they were now reinstalled on the drawers. To freshen up the drawers, I applied my DIY orange-scented soft wax. This not only rejuvenated the wood, but it gave the drawers a wonderful orange scent. I removed any excess wax with paper towels. The link to this recipe as well will be in the description. Don't forget to give this video a thumbs up if you're enjoying it. I certainly would appreciate it. Do you recall how terrible this dresser top looked? The first problem was the fact that there were 2 thick coats of paint, primer, and the finish to be removed. Then I found black ink spots scattered throughout. Let's not forget the severe scratch. Of course, I only made things worse by using 3 different strippers to remove the prior finish. As I started to apply the stain, I honestly had no idea if it would look acceptable once the stain dried. I figured I had nothing to lose, because if I didn't like how it looked stained, I would just paint the top black. To my surprise, the top looked great. The scratch had virtually disappeared. This is a close-up of where the scratch had been. The last thing I did was to apply 4 coats of water-based polyurethane. Oh, did you think I was finished with the dresser? Nope, not yet. This was the dresser that just kept giving. It keeps giving me more and more things to do. The 2 metal drawers, poles, had multiple coats of paint on them, so they too had to be stripped. They were not made of brass, so I sprayed them with gold paint. To protect them further, I sprayed them with 2 coats of satin lacquer. I was so very happy to finally install these drawer poles, because that was truly the last thing I needed to do to complete this project. As we look at the before and after photos, I will remind you what I said at the beginning of this video. I would never have refinished this dresser with the intent of making a profit. I purchased it because it was in such bad condition that I knew it would be a good dresser to show you lots of different techniques. I hope you learned something, and I hope you show your appreciation by becoming a subscriber to my channel. This dresser had its challenges, but I believe it looks amazing, and I'm very proud of the work I did to restore it. It will surely grace someone's home in a position of honor for another 50 years. If you have any questions, feel free to add them to the comments. I always respond to comments and enjoy the feedback from my viewers. On the right, you'll see several videos that provide additional information about how to refinish, restore, and restyle furniture so you can flip it for a profit or refinish it for your personal use. Thanks for watching.